Hi, welcome to Renee Marie's Stroke of Luck. I'm Renee Marie, and I really thought it was important for me to start the show paying honor and tribute to those that passed in the helicopter tragedy last week, including Kobe. I just drew a blank. Kobe Bryant. You know, it really ties into our show last week, because as that plane was taking off and crashing, we were talking about love, first of all, but we were also talking about Phil Jackson's 11 Ring book. And Phil Jackson was the coach of the LA Lakers. And in that book, Kobe is spoken about many times. So I don't know why we were connected at that particular moment, but I do know that Kobe is really, and all those that passed in that accident, really were a reminder to all of us that to be kind to one another, to love one another, and to just live for the moment and love each other, because life can pass you by in one split second. You could be taken from this earth. And, you know, that's why I'm so passionate about doing what we're doing, because, you know, I had a second chance at life. And the sad thing is Kobe Bryant and his daughter and those other seven people on that plane didn't have that opportunity. And it really brings me sadness, you know. I hope and pray that they didn't suffer. And I do believe that they are a shining light on us, like Luke Perry was when he suffered a stroke, bringing that attention that strokes can happen to anybody at any specific time, and it doesn't matter your age, it doesn't discriminate. So please love one another, be kind to one another, and I hope that this tragedy brings a little bit of uniting to our world, because our world is divided right now, and we need to work together to accomplish the goal. And the goal should be, how do we get there? How do we love one another? Like Phil Jackson took his model of teaching, of coaching, but he did it through love. He knew that he had to find out how to inspire each individual team player to really unite them. So, and when you're in business, you're in life, you really have to know how to, or try to listen to what is each person that you're talking to needs to be successful. Because the truth is, sometimes it's not about us, it's about that other person. So, once again, please love one another. Love one another. And to Kobe Bryant's wife, Vanessa, and all those, the families that passed, our hearts go out to you. They really do. And we hope that you'll be able to find strength in your loved ones, that they're at peace and they're not suffering. And I'm going to sing a little Amazing Grace so that we could just really come together. And then we're going to start the show, and we have two wonderful guests on the show. So here we go. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did grace my soul appear the hour I first believed. Please join me. Amazing
grace,
how sweet the
sound
that
saved
a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I
the deepest cuts.
I'm a little off today. Hello, everyone. good morning. I have to put my, you know what? Can we just put my my screen on for 1 second?
Yep, hold on.
So welcome. Well, let me introduce everybody. Welcome to Renee Marie Strokeluk. I was so in the Kobe Bryant mode that I forgot to put my mic on. So anyway, welcome to Renee Marie Strokeluk. This is Judy Marlowe, the co-host.
Hi,
Judy.
How are you?
You know, life happens. It doesn't matter.
I didn't even realize you weren't wearing it.
I know. I just ran over here and said, hello. So let me introduce, is our guest on the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So let me introduce our guest, and then we'll take maybe Jim could hide us for 2 seconds so I could put my, because you don't want me taking my shirt off while we're on the air. So I believe on the top of the screen is Tracy Lawrence. Hi, Tracy.
Hi, guys.
Good morning. Are they on, Jim? So,
hi, Kelly.
Tracy Lawrence, you know, I'm just going to step to the side, but Tracy Lawrence is on. Tracy Lawrence is my, a confidant of mine. She is a consultant of mine on the financial end, but she also is a dear friend of mine. And many years ago, we met when her band was willing to do a benefit for my softball marathon. And Tracy has really helped me to grow and to build that circle around me that you need in life. We talk about that circle all the time. But Tracy also is an author of the book Dementia Sucks, which she tells her story about caregiving for her parents. It's wonderful. But she's also on a new mission, and her new mission is to talk about encouraging the development of family caregiving friendly corporate cultures for business seeking better employment attraction and retention, which is very true, and that just ties right into everything that we have. The other guest we have via Skype is another dear friend of mine, Kelly Grimm. Hi, Kelly.
Hi, Kelly.
Hello, Judy, everyone.
So back in June, Tracy was a guest on our show. And Kelly and I were working together and discovered that Kelly's mom had suffered a stroke. And I really wanted to connect both of Tracy and Kelly. So I said, what better way to do it than on our show? And if you rewind that show, it really shows that, you know, Tracy was able to give some guidance to Kelly to help her on this new road that they had to travel down. So it was very, very, very interesting. But I'm gonna just move off camera for 1 second, and I'm gonna ask Tracy to give a little bit of information about her new purpose in life, and then we'll go to Kelly, and she'll tell us how her parents are doing. But Tracy, could you just take it away for 2 seconds?
Oh, absolutely. So good morning, and thanks for having me back. You know, as Renee alluded, I've been very involved in helping people who have aging loved ones to navigate, to understand the kinds of issues that they're going to face, and to try to get them to be a little more proactive instead of waiting until there's a crisis. Because too often, the adult children of aging parents tend not to do anything until they get that call, you know, your mom's in the emergency room, she fell, better get down here. And that's when everything starts going crazy, right? So I have been trying for the last 5 years to get the message out about how important it is to be proactive, to have certain documentation in place, to know things about your loved one so that when the worst happens, you'll be ready. So, and it's that way you're more effective and it's less stressful, and you know, everybody comes out a little better. And in the last couple of years, I noticed an important trend, and that is that there are a lot more jobs in our country, and there are about 6 million jobs that haven't been filled yet. And a lot of the people who are best qualified to fill those jobs are family caregivers. And if you've been on a job interview in recent history, hi guys, you'll know that when you go on a job interview, one of the benefits that they like to talk about is maternity leave. Now, for someone who's in menopause, maternity leave doesn't mean a whole lot.
Almost the same thing, you know, taking care of a newborn and really caring for your family.
True.
You know, your elderly family, your parents.
It's a lot of the same skill set, but there are some important distinctions. Number one, the person that you're caring for, okay, when you're a child, it's up to, you know, it's all on you. And you don't have to get any special documents.
Right.
When you take the child to the doctor to say that I'm responsible for this child, right? Until they reach the age of 18, you're on, right? But in this country, once somebody reaches the age of 18, they need to appoint an advocate.
Right. Right.
Because under HIPAA laws, medical people don't have to talk to you if you have not been appointed as the person's healthcare advocate.
Right.
So it's extremely important for adult children to understand that if their parent gets sick, they have to have some kind of legal document that says that they can speak for that person. It's extremely important.
I know, and I'm going through that in my family, and I'm unable to talk the person into it. So yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and that's certainly possible, but by having those things in place, it paves the way and makes it easier.
I know.
But what I came to realize was that, number one, people don't want to talk about this stuff because the first thing they think of is, you know, like they're in denial. They don't want to know that their loved one is actually going through this stuff. So they tend to brush it off and they make excuses and they don't do anything. And then something does happen, and they've been putting it off, and then they're in crisis mode, and then they've got a whole world of pain that they have to deal with.
Right.
But now we've got another situation. We've got employers who need to find people to fill the positions that they have available, and they have to hold on to the people they have. And very often, employees don't talk about the fact that they have this issue on their radar. Whether they're caring for a loved one now or in the near future, if they're not, you know, they're not thinking about it, and so when it does happen to them, all of a sudden they disappear. And a valued employee ghosts, right? All of a sudden they're not there anymore.
But Tracy,
and
is
nobody
that,
knows why.
Is it, is
so,
I mean, how about somebody, I understand what you're saying, like you're talking about employees that are going on interviews, right? And they're looking for jobs.
Or people who are working.
Right.
People who are currently,
you know,
working.
Or high functioning.
Right. So are you addressing the you're talking about the leaders of the corporate world. Am I correct?
Yes.
And you're trying to
absolutely.
You're trying to get them to understand, you know, you got this wonderful person, but they have this life situation on their hands, which we all are going to face one day in our lives. It doesn't matter who you are. You know, it
right.
could be somebody in your immediate family, or it could be a parent or whatever. But, you know, are you going to not honor their situation and let them? I mean, sometimes when I was in the hospital, when my father was in the hospital, I was working at Wanaku, and the board mm-hmm. and my manager, Janet, allowed me to work from the hospital. I took my laptop to the hospital for 2 weeks.
Sure.
For two weeks, and I was there. Like, their main concern was how my father and me and my father. But yet, I was able to work from that. So I was blessed.
Yes. And what a lot of people don't know is that under the law, there was a Family Leave Act passed. It's a federal law. Every company that has at least 50 people on site has to give their employees 12 weeks of unpaid leave without
wow.
jeopardizing their position.
Wow. Wow. So is that
And nobody
new?
knows this,
Is that
and
new?
employers don't share it because they're afraid that if they tell their employees, they might actually take the time off.
Oh my gosh. But the truth is that
So.
you, I mean, the truth is that we don't, I mean, I know me and my situation, and we're going to talk to Kelly yet, because she's going through this right now, is, you know, I didn't want to take off. I wanted to maintain my position, keep things up to
Sure.
par, but I needed to figure out for my father first.
I had to actually quit a job because my father had a massive stroke and there was no other choice. I had to be there.
Right.
Yep.
Kelly,
And
Kelly.
I went out when my mom was sick and she was in the hospital, I had to take family leave from my job. And I didn't even know that that was an option. And in the state of New Jersey, you can actually apply for benefits and get money. You
Wow,
could get
I didn't
paid
know about
while
that.
you're taking the time off
Wow.
if you fill out the right paperwork.
Wow.
And if nobody tells you that, you're missing out.
Yeah, that's very true.
So
Very true.
there's a world of information that employers can be furnishing to their employees. And if they did, they would be generating goodwill, they would be supporting better health in their employees, and they would be garnering greater loyalty. Plus, when the person took off, if they have the right mechanisms in place, then they would be training the other people in a team to be able to fill in for that person. So when that person takes the time off, they don't miss a beat. And the person who has to take the time off has less a stress on them because they know that their tasks are being attended to by someone who knows what they're doing. So they're not worried. It's one less thing for them to worry about while they're running down to the hospital and taking care of their loved one.
So let's just switch to Kelly for one second. Hi, Kelly.
Hi, Renee,
Hi.
Judy,
So
everyone.
how is your mom doing now? Just so we can get a quick update.
Sure. It's interesting. I was thinking this was back in June, and so much has happened in that short time. And, I could say everything Tracy said was exactly right. And it's proactive. We weren't proactive. We weren't ready. The hardest part, they're all just different parts coming together. Fast forward about a month ago, we found a nice assisted living private apartment. Of course, that's a lesson in and of itself, going and shopping and
Well,
looking and
I remember back when we were talking about it, let's pinpoint the moment.
the
You were like, that is not on our plate. And K Tracy's like, I wouldn't say no. I wouldn't say no.
Well,
I'm just saying, like,
the
go
challenge is
ahead.
stroke, was unexpected. And then at the time that they went through all of the diagnosis, that dementia, onset dementia came into the part of it as well. And although we had a small discussion among the remaining siblings, which are three of us, that guardianship may eventually be something we had to look at. The really bad part of that is if you wait and you're not proactive and they're not mentally capable, considered legally capable to make that decision, you're going through a court system that is quite a whole nother challenge.
I see Tracy
And
holding her head.
you're having your siblings on board to work together. We definitely hit a sad bump that we're still going through the court situation because one sibling decided they don't want her and they don't believe the diagnosis. They don't think she should be in this particular situation. And I will say, Tracy's book is fantastic. It'll make you
Thank
laugh
you.
and cry and go, yeah,
I really enjoyed
I
her book
bet.
as well.
So we are right at a place where, in fact, I just spent 3 days with my mom to give her a big surprise birthday party at the senior center. And having, she lived with me for a year 3 years ago, and now spending the 3 days in Missouri with her, it's like night and day as the progression and the changes. And it's hard to take yourself outside of the that's your mom, you're her kid, and instead you become the parent. Definitely, the way Tracy was talking about you, you know, become that parent. And so now it sounds like, Tracy, you're shedding light on a whole new area of information that's very useful and helpful. And I found myself having conversations with people, either the children or the parents. In fact, just the other day in my office, woman said she resisted senior living. You know, she had had a stroke, but she was feeling okay. And I honestly just had to share. Talk to your family now. Be proactive. Even if it's 1 year or 5 years down the road, do the things that need to be done.
Have the hard conversations.
And I wrote down, I told her she needed to get your book.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Before we move on, though, Kelly, I just want you to, I know you just stated this to one person, but share with our audience, like, sometimes that hard decisions of putting someone you love in a home, sometimes a decision you have to make, but it did better yours and your sister's ability to care for your mom.
It absolutely did. You know, it's hard when most families nowadays live in different states. We don't all live in the same place. And I felt the pain and the challenge that my sister that's there in Missouri with my mom was going through. She was 24-hour care, and then we would share expense of bringing in caregivers to give her a break and all. But I will say, you know, the fast forward part, although we're still going through the court battle in essence, but my mom's quality of life, I feel, is 10 times better. She's, you know, some days she's still herself, and then some days she's not the person that, you know, we know. And I can see too the quality of life for my sister just expanded. She's got sleep. You know, she was a lot more able to her visits with my mom. We use a lot of Skype and FaceTime, you know, for when she visits, and then I can, you know, feel like I'm right there with them and all. But the quality of life in finding, and you know, we looked at a lot of places, and a lot, that's the other side of it, is, you know, the younger you are, even as an adult child, you know, in having the conversations, I think about, you know, we could have been maybe a little more financially prepared as well, because there are lots of challenges, and it's not cheap for a nice place. But, you know, we kept looking and kept looking, and we came off the grid of finding a nice, smaller facility that had a beautiful apartment, and only like 40 folks in the community, I call it. And it just was, it worked. It was great, but we almost missed it. You know, we were looking at all the traditional.
That's a good idea to look outside the box. So Tracy, you know, I know this is off the beaten path a little bit, but you know, I know that we talk about the circle, that you're part of my circle. Kelly just was talking about not being prepared. I am so blessed that you have prepared me if something should happen to me. You know, you have to have those hard conversations, and it really is a hard conversation, but you and I had it a long time ago. But share with them what program that you have for me, because I'm not good at sharing it. I know it's only one out of, that's why you have to have people you trust to work on things, because I am not knowledgeable about insurances finances about insurances, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, when you came into my life, I trusted you, and, you know, you made me make the decision, but you gave me all the options that you thought were best for me. So just give them one option of the plan that I have through you, because I know it's like, you know, I pay every month, but I believe it's after 20 years, it's valued at $300,000. But if something should happen to me in the meantime, it goes right into effect. So talk a little bit about that.
Very good.
Sure. I used to hate life insurance. I used to think it was just like such a waste, because the idea of people like being worth more dead than alive was like really disturbing to me.
Right.
But in the last several years, I've learned that life insurance is an extremely valuable and important tool that everyone should look at. And the younger you are and the more healthy you are, the more important it is for you to look at, because it's cheaper when you do it when you don't need it, right?
Right.
So in my sphere, a lot of people ask me about long-term care insurance, right? And, you know, and the first thing they say is, oh, it's so expensive. Mm-hmm. And guess what? Yeah, it ain't cheap. But here's the thing. As Kelly was alluding, the care that you need when you get older and you're sick is so expensive, it can be crippling. And it can completely bankrupt a family. And so what I advocate for, and I have this for myself, I have it for my husband, and I have it for Renee. I suggested a product that is life insurance, but also serves the role of long-term care insurance if you need it. It can also be used for chronic care expenses, critical care expenses, terminal illness. And we have a mix of products. There are different kinds that you can look at. But the whole idea is that you put in a little bit of money, and if you die, then the people you love get a great big pile of money from that little bit of money. But what I like to point people towards are products that it's not just about death benefit, right? It's about living benefits.
Right.
It's about having access to money when you need it. I'll give you a great example. I have a friend who at the age, she was in her late 30s and was diagnosed with breast cancer. Mm. Okay? She's got a little girl. And she was going for chemotherapy. And on the day of her first treatment, she got a call from the clinic where she was going for the therapy, and they said, we can't give you the chemotherapy because your insurance won't pay for it, and you have to pay for it up front. So fortunately, her insurance broker saw her post on Facebook and called her and said, listen, you have this benefit. And she had a term insurance policy that had living benefits, and she was able to use the money in her policy to buy her chemotherapy drugs.
Wow.
And here she is 5 years later. She's alive. She's healthy. Her little girl is fine. She's engaged to get married again. And, you know, and everything is, you know, is going, she's in school to become a nurse. So what I'm saying is, if you have the right kinds of tools in place, then you will be ready for an array of situations that could come your way in life. And I suggest that everyone in earshot should be talking to a professional about this kind of coverage, because it's extremely important for you and your loved ones.
Well, like you said, Tracy, about the other, you know, when people are working and they could take a 12-week leave, we didn't know that. I mean, we
right.
always thought that, you know, death or what are they called? Life insurance. What is it? Life insurance was for when you passed away. You right?
Yeah.
Not life insurance. What is
well,
it called?
Life insurance was to protect those that were there.
Yeah. Right. After
right.
Passed.
Right. Right. But people should also look at living benefits.
Living benefits.
Okay.
But do I have living benefits, or is it called
a... You do.
Oh, it's living.
You do.
Oh. Well, listen.
You absolutely do.
Yeah, but
I wouldn't have given you something that didn't.
Right, but what I did, because I'm not... I know my good points and I know my bad points. But, you know, I have Tracy's number and my girls have Tracy's number. And if anything should happen, they know to reach out to Tracy, because Tracy will guide them. And I'm just
yes.
saying, like, we talk about that circle of people all the time, you know, that you need to have that circle around you to help you with things. And Tracy is a gift to me that she's one of them. So.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. But it's so important, Tracy, like all this information that you need to know in life, you know, and people don't know.
Well, they don't point out when, you know, like my dad bought life insurance for me. I don't think they ever pointed that out to him.
No. But you know what? Maybe they didn't know. You know what I'm saying? Maybe they were just selling life insurance. They don't know. But Tracy went more in depth and was like, Tracy was like, I don't like this. This doesn't make sense to me. So, right? Am I correct? So you went and you found out other things, you know?
Yeah. Well, you know, when I was taking care of my mom, and I was put in charge of making her money last as long as she lived, right? I was very unhappy with the solutions that I was offered by my bank. Like, yeah, deposit all that money with us and we'll give you 0.04% interest.
Right.
What?
Right.
Excuse me?
Right.
Are you high? Right. So, you know, I decided to go out and learn for myself what options are available.
Right.
And, you know, and I learned that life insurance is an extremely powerful tool.
Right.
So, especially for people who are younger.
Right.
You know,
right.
The people who want insurance are people who are like too, you know, they're too old to qualify.
But I was
too sick to qualify.
Right.
But for people who are young and healthy, go out and get it.
Find
a professional, and if you can't find a professional, contact me. I'll connect you with a professional.
And if you have life insurance, you should find out if you have the living benefits.
Absolutely. You need to know, like, what your policy does for you.
Right.
A lot of people just, like, you know, they meet a professional, and they hear, wah, 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 but they don't know what they're talking about, right? So... And unfortunately, a lot of people out there are, you know, they're out there to make money, make a commission.
Yeah.
If I was that kind of person, I wouldn't be on this show, right?
Yeah. So. Well, you won't be in my circle because I like people that are authentic, you know, people that do things from their heart, you know, because when we met originally, you weren't there to sell me anything.
How did you meet?
I was having a softball marathon, which I'll never do another softball marathon.
Lost a lot of windshields at that event.
Oh my God. And not only that, but we had a band and it was raining and electrical and I'm like, never again. But you know, and I had to, so it was crazy. But anyway, so Tracy's band was a part, was doing their benefit, doing singing and doing a benefit for me. So, you know, so it was more like she just kind of got introduced to me. And then we were talking, and I don't know how we got on the subject of finances and money. But the truth was that she has doing me a favor, a benefit for the goodness of everybody. So I knew that her heart was in the right place. It wasn't about her making money.
I think
it.
God sent her to you.
Yeah, I'm sure. Before we get to Kelly, I just want to reiterate one thing. You know, you talk about young people. But I was age about 50. So as soon as you can find out, you need to start it. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Yes, you should start it at 18. But even if you don't, start it as soon as you get the awareness to start it.
Yeah. If you're a young professional, if you're in your 20s or 30s and you haven't started yet, a lot of people say, "Oh, well, I don't have a family. I don't have kids. Why do I need insurance?"
Right. Right.
Oh my God! You do need insurance. Yeah. You need it for you.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what people need to understand. Life insurance isn't just about death benefit. It's not just about heirs. It's not just about beneficiaries. It's about you. It's about having the resources in place to be able to pay for whatever it is you need when life brings you whatever it's going to bring you. Because it's never all ponies and sunshine.
Life is a challenge. Tracy, so your mom, you know, you got her in this place. You're all, like, kind of settled in.
Oh, Kelly.
Kelly. Kelly.
I was wondering why you said that.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, she is. It's still a struggle. The first, you know, it's been only a month. And not having a car and driving and the freedom to, you know, come and go as, you know, an 84-year-old person has certainly had plenty of freedom opportunities. And so that challenge, there's a lot of emotional struggle for that. I do want to jump out and say, because I was involved in insurance earlier on, and Tracy's right, and in fact, I could tell plenty of stories that having, even starting with something in life insurance, the earlier you do, because you're healthy, you know, even having it for your children long before, I had family that they didn't get it for their infant. I mean, who thinks about that?
Right.
But at 10 months old, their child was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis, and you know, there was no chance of that child then having life insurance. And if you purchase it right, you know, you can expand and increase it as they get older. So these are things, you know, I have racing in my mind, you know, all of these different things that coulda, woulda, shoulda, thoughts of, you know, how I wish we had done some things differently. Some I don't think we could have. But so in our life, we have a daughter. You know, these are serious things I'm thinking about. And it seems like it's a magnet now. You know, anytime I hear a conversation, you know, my heart goes out to, you know, I need to know all I can possibly know so that I can reach out and help some others. You know, spending time too with my mom in her assisted living, you know, the concept with her was, I don't want to hang out with all those old people.
Mm-hmm. That's funny.
Yeah.
That's really funny because before my dad was ill, he lived in a senior housing area and garden apartments, and they had a hall. And on New Year's Eve, they had a big party. And I said, oh, are you going to the party? He goes, no, I'm not gonna hang out with old people.
Even though we're the same age, right? Even though they're the same age.
No, I'm not gonna do it.
Well, it's funny because my dad, I'll never forget this. He was walking, I used to own a deli in Hawthorne, and he was walking, it was next to an apartment building, so he was walking one of the 85-year-old women home. He was very kind, my father. He'd carry things over and stuff. So, but he asked her, like, how does it, because I guess he was 60 at the time, maybe 50, 60, and he asked her, how does it feel to be 85? and she, her answer was very prominent.
Yes.
It was, my body, you know, my mind thinks I'm 25, but my body just can't keep up anymore. So, but that's
that.
The truth, because, you know, I don't look at myself like 50s. I mean, I don't think of myself as 57, you know? That number just doesn't jive, doesn't even, like, matter to me because of, you know,
the way you think, the way you act.
So.
And you have to keep very active.
Yes. So, Kelly, I'm sorry to cut you off. Go ahead.
No, I actually, you know, being there, and I came and had breakfast and lunch in the dining hall and really wanted to meet all the different folks that were there. And they were all in different stages of health, you know, higher risks for falling and different things. But their similar part was, you know, most, and I was kind of prying in the conversation, most had not prepared or had discussions with their children or vice versa. And then those that did resisted, and they all had the same story of wish they had planned better, thought about how much healthier they could have lived, you know, to be healthier in their older ages. You know, so there's this constant, you know, circle and cycle of the conversations that, although I was a little jealous, because when someone, like, cleans your room and does your laundry and makes you whatever you want to eat, I said, you know, I'll tell you what, let's just trade for a week or two. I'm going to move into your apartment. But it really is something that is a huge highlight now, you know, like your ears will perk up when you hear a conversation, you know, that someone's having. Even I've heard people having conversations at the restaurant, oh, mom, you know, we just want you to be safe and healthy. And, you know, that's why we got the caregivers that come to the home and things. But it really is a financial challenge.
I know.
If you're not prepared.
I mean, expensive.
You know,
I mean, how much
it can hurt your family a lot.
I know. I mean, we were just looking at a few for my mother-in-law, and I mean, like, we're talking like $13,000 a year. Some are $10,000, they're $8,000. I mean, a year, a month. I mean, it's
what?
Yes, right.
In New Jersey, the average is $15,000 right now.
A month. So if you
that's for nursing homes. There are alternatives that are cheaper, but yeah, it's crazy expensive if you have to self pay.
And what are the alternatives, Tracy?
Oh well, as Kelly was saying, you know, like there are smaller places that are, like for instance, I had my mom in group homes that were equipped to handle dementia. And for my mom, it was extremely important to be in a small setting because she was so, she was psychotic and she was violent.
Wow.
So if she perceived that the people around her were talking and not including her, she was sure that they were plotting against her.
Oh, God. Wow. That's
and
sad.
My mom she got thrown out of the rehab that she was in at one point for threatening people with knives.
Wow.
That's how, you know, she grabbed you know those stainless steel knives that they have in the dining rooms with the little serrated edge. She was threatening people with those things.
Wow.
And the police came and took her away, which was hilarious. But that's another story.
I can't imagine. You know.
but the thing is that, you know, and what I want to say to and Kelly, my heart does go out to you and your family, because I know that whole idea of putting your loved one in a home is such a horrible idea for most people. They just, like, they can't even, like, envision putting their loved one in one of those places. But there are a range of types of places out there, and if you find the right one, then it's actually a gift, because your loved one will get the care that they need. And what people don't understand is that when they're in the position of being a hands-on caregiver for their parent, they're no longer the child, right? They lose that relationship.
Yeah.
And they are tasked with being the authority, right? They are tasked with being the person in charge. And they are tasked with being the person who's doing all these difficult things. And they no longer have that gift of being that person's child. It's taken away from them. So when you let yourself let go of that notion that I will never put my parents in a home, and you start looking for a place that will partner with you,
yes,
to give care to your loved one, you're in a completely different space, and your loved one will be able to eventually acclimate to the place if it's the right one.
Right.
And you will get back that relationship. At least at times, right?
Yeah.
When that person has a lucid window and they know that you're their kid, they will act like your parent again.
Right.
So you get them back for little pieces of time, and you get yourself back. You get to be that, you know, my mom's daughter again.
Right.
And that's something that people have to understand. When you're being a caregiver, you are giving up that relationship.
Right. Right.
So you owe it to them, and you owe it to yourself to let go of that notion that I will never put my loved one in a home, because there are lots of different ways that you can situate your loved one that will be good for them, that will be better for them. And with my mom, just one last thing, the ironic thing was when I put her in their first group home, she was initially thrilled to be there, but after a couple of weeks she was pissed off because she was around people who were less cognitively equipped than she was. Mm-hmm. And she felt like, you know, I felt like I had my sixth grader in with a bunch of kindergartners.
Right.
And she was very upset and she wanted to leave. And I was upset and I was crying because I didn't know what to do with her anymore.
Right.
And finally, somebody, a social worker who worked for the home, was visited with my mom and got on the phone with me and said, look, would you agree that your mother is where she needs to be right now? And I said, yeah, I guess. I mean, she needs that care. And he said, you know, you have to understand that one of the reasons that she's upset is because they're doing such a good job of keeping her cognitively intact. So that's right. The ironic part of this.
Right.
You know,
right.
If they're doing their job, then right. She's going to feel like she's in the wrong place because she's still functioning at a pretty high level.
Right. Yeah.
Kelly. And so, you know, so it's, you know, you got to understand you're walking a tightrope between what they need and what they think they want. Yeah. And you know, and you go to any home, doesn't matter how great it is, and you talk to the people at the home, the number one thing they're going to say to you is, I want to go home.
Yeah, my grandmother said that continuously.
It doesn't matter. Sometimes they can be at home and say that to you, and that's what you have to understand. because they don't understand. It's not that they're saying they literally want to go home. I've learned this. What they're saying to you is, I want to go back to like myself.
I know exactly what you meant.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. So, Kelly, is your mom experiencing that as well, that she...
You know, actually, that was the big conversation with my sister and I, is she... Sabrina said, you know, mom's bored, you know, because she is functioning, you know, in a different way than a lot of the other folks around her. And she taught, you know, we really did luck out where she's at is a just small enough and just big enough to accommodate. And Tracy, you're exactly right that I could feel they were doing things really well because she is as high functioning as I could even imagine, even with the roller coaster of time. But she definitely, you know, is still very active, and we get those great functioning days where she's the parent, you know, and she'll, you know, make comments that are just like our mom would do, you know. But you're right that finding that right one, we almost went to a different place. It was a little bigger, more institutionalized. And like I said, we found this one that's just a little smaller. The challenge for her, actually, the other day, she was sitting in one of the rooms where everyone gathers, TV room, and one of the ladies coming down her hall tripped and fell, and my mom was right there to, you know, get help, and, you know, so on the other side of it, on my mom's, you know, great days of all, so she's feeling needed, too. So there's just this huge array of emotions of, you know, the staff is great. And that's part, I think, we feel a sense of trust, you know, and confidence in the people that are caring for her. That's another really important thing, that finding the right place, you know, and like you said, you know, the challenge of there still are some ahead of us. You know, as she goes to another level, we're trying to think about planning for that, because on the next level, we don't know, is it a year, is it 5 years, but that next level is another expense. So we really are examining what do we do at that next level, because actually, other than her blood pressure at this point, you know, her health overall using a cane is really good. She's a strong old horse, you know.
How old is she?
She'll probably be 100.
I think she's 84.
She's 84, Kelly?
Yeah. She's 84, yeah.
That's young. That's young nowadays.
It is.
You know, other than the dementia that, you know, she's suffering from, it's young. So, Tracy, let's get back to, because we only have a few more minutes. I just really wanted to... end with, I'm going to ask Kelly something as well, but I just wanted to end with you going back to your purpose now, your goal with the corporate offices. I mean, have you been going around, you know, sharing that light with people?
Oh yeah. And I have several prospects. My goal for this year is to do a pilot.
Oh.
And yeah, so once I it involves finding out how many people in the business are affected, with an anonymous survey, and then proposing that those who are in that position come on board to do focus groups and create a range of resources that would have value specifically for them that the company could support. And you know, a lot of these initiatives aren't expensive because they're things that the company has to do for their employees anyway. So this is just a matter of creating workshops and a set of resources that people can go to so they understand what their rights are, what things they can do right now, and encourage them to do them with the support of the company that pays them, right? Is this why I'm going to be getting to people earlier in the process? Right. If they're still working, then I got time.
Right.
Because you know, you guys know, if they're still working, then they haven't hit that crisis where they have to remove themselves.
Right.
So to create a culture that supports family caregiving, that lets them know it's okay to say that they do it, that they will not be punished, that they will not be overlooked for promotions, that they will be paired up or teamed up with others who are in their situation so they can learn each other's job. So when somebody's got to leave in an emergency, they got other people who can plug in, connect them with legal resources, connect them with financial resources, connect them with all kinds of information that can prepare them so that they can stay productive as long as possible and come back, right? Because when you're working for an employer that is providing all of these tools to you, why would you leave?
That's right.
And if they're giving you flex time and they're giving you the ability to work from home when you need to, and they're doing innovative things like a lot of companies, bigger companies, have daycare on site, right?
Yeah.
You can also have elder care on site, right? Like a daycare center.
Yeah.
And if you put older people and little kids together, guess what happens?
Yeah.
They all benefit.
Yeah.
Right? Because these little kids have grandma, grandpa time, even though these people aren't literally their grandma and grandpa, right?
True.
But they have people that they can spend time with. So, and it's beautiful for everybody. Everybody benefits. And you could come down at lunch and check on your loved one, right? Yeah. Just like you would with your child, you can check on your loved one and bring them home with you at the end of the workday.
Right. And it gives them something to do. You know, to get up and go.
I'm going with you to work.
Yeah.
Exactly. And you don't have to make a special stop because you're bringing them to where you work.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of innovative things that we can be doing in the business world that make people healthier, more productive, more prepared, loyal, and you know. But it takes a cultural shift in these companies. So once I complete a pilot where I can demonstrate that this is working, then I'm going to take that pilot to the world at large. I'm going to train people in how to actually conduct and construct these programs at different companies, and I'm going to be saving lives all over the place and making money to support
myself. You've got material for another book.
Yeah. Hey, you know, I've already got a couple half written. But before I go, I just wanted to mention I'm doing something really exciting in June. I am going to be keynote speaker on a dementia-friendly cruise.
I saw that on Facebook.
Oh, that's wonderful.
You sent it to me.
I'm going
to
be on the Queen Mary 2. Elite Cruises they have these amazing cruises for caregivers and their loved ones. So the loved ones come along, they get cared for by professional caregivers so that the caregivers themselves can get respite and travel and fresh air and workshops so that they can learn
That's
how to practice
fabulous.
Self-care.
Kelly, maybe we'll go because we could, because you know what, we could learn from Tracy, and then maybe you could bring it down to your mom's area and you could do something like that for your mom. Or maybe Tracy can go down and lead it the way.
Actually, Tracy, I wanted to throw out to you, not that it needs an answer at all, but as I've thought about, you know, the family lead that you were talking about, and I look at our situation, you know, family leave, I remember when, you know, I had my daughter, was this window of time, and you were gone the whole time. But right. I found that, I would love to see that companies actually allowed it to be spread out over a 12 or 24 month period where it was shorter times, like one day a week or 3 days a month. Like, so I could go take a visit, make a visit to my mom and then come back and then not
you
be
can.
For a month. Oh, you can.
You can. It's over a 52 week period.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So yeah, so you can take 12 weeks within a year.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Fabulous. Wow.
Yeah, and depending
great,
on where you
great
live.
Information to share.
Yeah, if you live in New Jersey, you can apply for benefits to get compensated. And in New York, employers also have to pay for insurance to pay you. So different states have different laws, but the federal law is that they have to give you time off and guarantee that your job is there for you.
Well,
so it's unpaid time, but at least it's there for you. So it's 12 weeks, but it can be taken piecemeal over the course of a 52-week period. And then after the 52-week period ends, it starts all over again.
Wow.
We're gonna so have every year you get another 12 weeks.
We're going to have to start wrapping it up, but I just wanted to give Kelly the opportunity to share her experience, like for the last, like briefly, Kelly. Just give us your experience of how this, what it's almost about 6-7 months that it, how it has been.
Yeah. Like I said, the struggle was as being so far away, that the challenge and frustration was being so far away while my one sister seemed to be carrying the biggest burden. And then thank goodness for technology and lots of Skype and FaceTime visits, that can bring ones of us together. The court part of guardianship and that challenge of when you have to, literally the legal terms are incapacitated, they're tough words to bring about. And finding good caregivers coming into your home and being available, not just for, occasional, but, my sister was dealing with her, spouse's mother, very, very ill and unfortunately just passed away. She's also the guardian for a neighbor woman and needed more caregivers more often. And the challenge was, have a strong pipeline for that.
Wow.
I feel like, between your book, Tracy, and our experience, I've just really started to write these things down to find the challenge and then some solutions. But my most recent visit was probably the funnest, the happiest. My mom loves Olive Garden like nobody's business. And so we decided to throw a surprise party catered by Olive Garden with a wonderful man who made a cake that looked like an Olive Garden restaurant, to the point that the Olive Garden then had a bunch of nice things to hand off to my mom because she was such a devoted, weekly visitor. So
that's so nice.
It was so nice being in the place where she's at, the community, I call it, and meeting all the other amazing people. I didn't want to leave. I want to go back as soon as I can, because it is so comforting to have a place that you feel that is the right one for them too. And so my journey continues, and my mistake, and I just ordered it last week, is my is not getting the book to my other sister, and so she's going to get one that maybe the court battle will, find its way, to us coming back together, because you really do. It takes a village, a family, friends.
I certainly hope so. I hate to break everybody up, but we could all talk and talk and talk. And I would like to invite you both back at the same time, because we have really good conversations together. And it really is important that we keep this conversation alive to just touch on people, you know. So please come back. Judy will set it up, even if it's in like 4 months or 5 months, just so we could keep letting people
keep
know.
Keep the conversation, you know, going.
Because Tracy, I mean, Kelly, you bring hope to people, and Tracy, you just bring hope and so much information and knowledge, you know. And it really is a blessing to have both of you as my friends and Judy's friends and really confidants in our lives to help us. Like you said, it takes a village. So I can't thank you enough, both of you.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure. Yes. And Kelly, if you need to reach out. I'm here. I'm happy to help any way I can.
I've learned so much. Thank you. Definitely.
You're so welcome, and best of luck. Blessings to you and your mom and your family.
Our final court case is mid-April. The judge has said there'll be no more extensions. This will be final, witnesses and all that fun stuff. So I'll have some news after that. So
okay, well, good luck with that. I hope that the best possible outcome comes from it.
Tracy, it will.
Before we go, really quick, give your contact information.
Anybody who wants to find me, go to grandfamilyplanning.com and hit the contact, and you can fill in a little form and it'll go to me, and just let me know what you're looking for, because I want to make sure that you're not a robot. And it's got that site's got links to all my other stuff, including my book. And if you can't remember grandfamilyplanning.com, just go to dementiasucks.com.
Dementia Sucks.
And it's a wonderful book.
That will connect to me as well.
Yes, yes.
It's a very informative book.
You know what? On the next show, we'll have a discussion about that book.
Great.
We'll have you read some of it. Kelly will have the book in front of you. We'll really have a conversation about Dementia Sucks. And, you know, the tie-in to strokes is just that we all need to support each other. And you need to find humor in everything. And really, you need that team of circle around you.
It's a very good book for caregivers to read.
Yes. Yes. So we'll do
that. Thanks, Judy.
And maybe we'll have Ann on next one.
Yes.
That one as well. Thank you so much. We got to go. We ran 10 minutes over. Thank you, Jim, for allowing us to do that. I didn't want to cut anybody off. Everybody had so many wonderful things to say. But we're blessed, and we, once again, we want to give our heart condolences to Kobe Bryant and those nine people that went down on that tragic thing. And I keep saying this, and I know everybody has joined together in saying this, that life is short, and you have to really value life.
Appreciate every single day.
Every single day.
It's a gift.
Every single moment. It's a gift. And that was the last line to my book, Stroke of Luck, is life is a gift.
Yes.
It's the last line, the last verbiage in my book. And I actually put it on Facebook, and I actually, because it's such a strong statement. It's just a strong statement, and that really is the key to what I really wanted to let everybody know. Through my book and through my writings and everything. So thank you so much for joining us today.
Yes.
Thank you, Tracy. Thank you, Kelly. And I'm blessed to have you both in my life. And thank you, Jim. You're a gift as well with this platform. It really is a wonderful thing. We're going to blow our kisses. Is Judy and Kelly still there? Kelly and Tracy still there?
Yep.
Can we blow our kisses, ladies? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Bye, everybody.
God bless you all.
Bye.
Bye.
God bless you. Take care.
Of where I stand. Oh.